I'm Tommy Shaw, and this is Premier Guitars Big Five. Well, I have a few favorites, but this is the most precious to me. And I call it Uncle Bob because my Uncle Bob was a producer and guitar player, songwriter. His big hit was Kiss Me Baby that Narvel Feltz recorded. But he lived up in Michigan, and he passed away when I was really young. So I was never aware of him. I don't know if I ever met him my cousin came to me about 12 years ago and said that her mom, who was my mother's sister, was starting to have health issues, and they wanted to move her into their house. They were trying to raise some money to redo a bedroom and make it into like a little apartment for her. And she said, I wanted to see if you might want to buy Dad's guitar. I didn't even know he was a musician. And so I said, send me a picture. So she sent me a picture, and it was, I don't know if you remember that far back when people would send a big file, you would see it start to slowly come in like that. The picture was coming in like this. And I was going, that's a Telecaster with a black pick guard. She didn't know anything about it. So I called Norm's Guitars, and I said, how do I identify this guitar? And he says, well, it's a black, it's a black guard Tele. So it's 50 something. He said, take the ashtray off and see if there's a little dopple of, solder in the palm of it like that. If that's it, then you have a 1954. I said, what's the right, I don't want to pay her too little for it. I want to give her the fair prices. If a dealer came along and said, I'll give you this for it. So he told me what the right price was, and so I got it from her, and I've had it ever since. And one of the things I love about it is I can see where my uncle's arm was when he played, right there. And I see it where his knee was, right there. So it's that's the cool thing about guitars. They are little time machines, or cornerstones. They take things in and they hold on to them. And I firmly believe that all those vibrations that go from this piece of wood into this piece of wood, across this metal and all that, it leaves some sort of residue in there. That's why some guitars just feel soulful. And this one feels soulful. And I've got some acoustics that are like that. And it may just be quackery, but it's what I like to believe. I think of all the heartache and love and births and deaths and marriages and good things that happen. There's all kind of, it's a little bit in all those guitars. That sounds like a Tele. My desert album, and this may surprise you too, would be, what's the title of it? Miles Davis. So what? So what? Miles Davis. It's just, it's this perfect jazz album. It's not a trendy album. It might have been at the time. But it's just so soulful. My biggest guitar pet peeve right now is kind of a manufacturing thing. Because these big companies, they tend to want to be bigger companies, and a lot of times you have guys who don't appreciate what it is they're making, and they have good people working there, but the people at the top, it's a big, you want to be this big successful corporation. And I really had hoped when Gibson got sold, because the guy who ran it before, he was into electronics, and he was putting, you remember when they put those self-tuning tuners on Les Pauls and they were blue? And I had friends over there who said, do you want one of those? I was like, no, Hell no. I'll tune my own guitar, thank you very much. Now they're doing, their sales are really up. But I've been a Gibson guy my whole life. You know, I used to, people would, you know, help me out over there. But guys like me, and there's guys in other bands that, you know, sold millions of records. Unless you've got a guy over there who can circumvent you, you can't get a guitar. I've been trying to get a Firebird from them for a couple of years, and it's like, nope, can't help you. I want a custom shop because it's, you know, you need, they're the sturdiest built. They're for professionals, and they're meant to be out on the road. So that's my pet peeve, is that the people who have these classic model guitars, the Stratocasters and the Les Pauls and the 335s and the Telecasters and that sort of thing. You know, my advice to them is, you know, don't try and fix it. It does not need fixing. Just make them as well as you can, and they'll be worth something in a few years. Cause some of these experimental ones with, you know, a hollow body, solid body guitar with a sound hole and sound hole on the top, and it's they look cool and they're kind of gimmicky, but I would rather see, I would buy like their main classic instrument, the Telecaster or the Stratocaster. I have a Bajo Sexto. I've got a custom baritone guitar that was made from a jazz master and a neck that my buddy pulled out of the reject garbage can. It just, I don't even know what the flaw was, but he built that baritone for me, and it's a fantastic guitar. That's a useful guitar. So that's my biggest pet peeve. There's an old saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. You might be surprised by this, but my all-time favorite guitar is a lifetime favorite, would be Wes Montgomery. And it's somebody that I discovered when I was 14, 15 years old. And just a heartbreaker of a guitar, a jazz player. And he had his own personal style where he played with just his bare thumb. And he would play octaves. And it was just so beautiful, and he could hang with Jimmy Smith. There, in fact, there's a Verve record with Wes Montgomery and Jimmy Smith, and it's just insane. I cried when he died. It was like losing a favorite uncle, you know. Well, it's a combination of the Bogner Shiva. I guess it's vintage. It's the one with the green metal back up on the inside. You turn it around where the works are. It's green. I call it a green back Bogner. And it's something that Willie Mankiewicz turned me on to when we were recording the Mission album. You know, I was playing through Marshalls and had a couple of heads and some AC 30s and whatever's and a matchless and all good amps, but when we plugged this thing in and turned it up a little bit, it was like the best sounding Marshall I've ever had. It's just that point where you get that compression in that tube, that tubiness, that when you drive it the right amount and you the right amount of bass, when you twist those knobs, it makes a difference. It's not just like, I think I can tell the difference. It's pretty radical. And it sounds so good in the mix. Whether you're high-gaining it or whether you're playing it clean, it's just a dandy little weapon right there. I switched to all Bogners live now. So that combination has been really good, you know, with just a few little pedals. I've got a big one called a Big One pedal that is a little bit of a secret weapon too. Here it is. Built in Austin, Texas, the Big One. Lee Jackson. It's just chock full of the highest quality electronics that money can buy. So it's a heavy, expensive thing, but he just went to the trouble of just making this thing the best it could possibly be. You step on that and you just like, how much rocket fuel do you want to put in there? My guitar tech was a little, really, you know, he was skeptical about it until he tried it, and then he was like, woo! Yeah, so it's a big secret weapon.